This is the Almost Timely newsletter for the week of May 26th, 2024. Content authenticity statement, 100% of this week's newsletter was generated by me, the human. Learn why this kind of disclosure is important and might be required for anyone doing business in any capacity with the EU in the near future. There's a link at the top of the newsletter. What's on my mind this week? Your future as an AI professional. This week, I am finally off the road after a marathon of business travel that took me up and down the East Coast to the West Coast and to the South Coast of Australia. During that time, I had the pleasure and privilege to speak to audiences large and small in industries like travel and automotive, food and grocery, architecture, engineering, construction, about, what else? Generative AI. Throughout my journeys, a few common themes kept recurring, so I thought we'd go over them today. The first biggest commonality among all the audiences is the partially mistaken belief that generative AI's primary purpose is generation of content from blog posts to social media content, etc. Believe it or not, generation, despite the name, is the use case category that generative AI is least good at. Why? Why is that the case? Well, ultimately, generative AI is nothing more than a prediction machine, right? Attempting to predict the next word, or the next pixel. Prediction is inherently about probability rather than reality, about guessing what should come next. When you're guessing, inevitably you're going to guess wrong, and machines do. So what are the other use cases that it's better at? In the keynote I've been giving for 2 years now, which despite that lengthy track record, has never been the same twice because everything keeps changing, I outlined 6 major use cases of language models. Generation, extraction, summarization, rewriting, classification, and question answering, although I'm tempted to rename the last one synthesis, but that's for another time. The other 5 use cases are all about generative AI using it to transform existing data as opposed to making new stuff. What are some examples of these other use case categories, the ones people didn't realize generative AI was capable of doing? I showed a whole bunch of examples the last couple of weeks, like extracting meeting notes and action items for call recordings and transcripts, analyzing social media content to determine what content resonated best with an audience, the unstructured data, synthesizing an ideal customer profile and having conversations with it, building a go, no-go application that helps a company decide what RFPs it wants to bid on, analyzing a federal budget to determine second-order effects on your industry, the consequences unforeseen of legislation or budgets, inferring a competitor's 12 to 18 month overall corporate strategy from public information, and validating that we completed a proposal to meet all the requirements given. None of these use cases are about writing blog content or Facebook posts. Honestly, I mean, those are valid use cases, but that's like taking a Harrier jump jet to the grocery store. Yes, it can do that, but it's capable of so much more. All these use cases are about leveraging a language model's understanding of language itself to accomplish tasks that would take us 100 times more time and effort to do. Why didn't audiences do these things already with AI? Because in so many cases, what they've learned about AI, what they've read about in the media or seen on LinkedIn or heard at conferences has been very pedestrian use cases. Now, to be sure, if using generative AI to write social content saves you a few hours a week, that is a worthy use case. That's still worth doing. But again, these tools are capable of so much more. So how do we fix this narrow scope of vision when it comes to generative AI? With more and more examples. And ideally, examples that allow people to build their own tools so they can explore their own use cases fully. In the workshop I did this past week, participants went home with custom GPTs that they built with their own hands during the workshop. And because of that, they were excited to use them. And none of these were generation. Right? They were all other use cases. And more important, they'll be able to maintain and share these tools that they built when they get back to the office. Which brings me to the second common theme this past week, 2 weeks. Generative AI does best when you give it more data to work with. If you're going to use it for generation, your prompts are or should be huge. to give it the best chance of predicting what you want it to do. If you're using it for a task like summarization, chances are your prompt itself is going to be much shorter by comparison because you're just going to give it all the data it needs to work with. Right? It doesn't have to invent anything. It doesn't have to generate anything. It's like, oh, here's this big, huge transcript. I can work with this. If you want better and better results from generative AI, provide more and better data. The risk of hallucination, meaning an answer that is statistically correct inside the model, but factually wrong, goes down as you provide more data. Think of a large language model like ChatGPT or whatever as a librarian in a library. And the library is all the training data that the model was trained on. And the librarian is the small part of the model that does the retrieval. The technical term is literally retrieval heads. Really large libraries, models in this analogy like GPT-4 Omni or Gemini 1.5 or Anthropic Claude, are likely to have more of what you asked for, but there's still plenty of books in the world, plenty of knowledge in the world that most libraries don't have, and plenty of knowledge that these language models weren't trained on. So what does the librarian do in this analogy? In an effort to be helpful, they return the closest similar book. Except remember that they're returning word by word instead of book by book. But it's like you go to the library and you ask for The Joy of Cooking and they come back with The Joy of Sex. And it's very close in language, but not at all what you asked for. That's hallucination. Right? It's not making up gibberish. It's pulling things back that are statistically relevant but factually wrong. And the smaller a model is or the more specific your prompt is without the data being provided, the more likely it is to hallucinate because the library doesn't have the books. The model does not have the knowledge. One of the things I say at the end of my keynotes is that your present and future success with generative AI is largely contingent on the quality and quantity of data you have behind the four walls of your organization. Whoever has the most best data will have a strategic advantage because everyone else has the generic, more surface-level public data baked into every major language model. As a result, if you're using just the model with none of your data, that'll result in the same general public content that everyone can generate. There's no strategic advantage there. And to be clear, when I say your data, I'm not talking just spreadsheets and database. This is everything that is your data, from emails you write to conversations and calls you record and piles of imagery laying around and photo albums to, you know, snapshots of the whiteboards in the office to post-its on the CEO's desk. All of that is data. All of that is knowledge. If it is information that's useful, if it's knowledge, that is what can go into a language model. For example, a lot of people say, well, I can't get AI to write like me. Well, if AI isn't capturing your voice or writing style, it's because you're not providing enough examples of it. Given enough examples, both digested into summaries and as is, most generative systems these days can quite capably replicate a writing style. You just got to give it a lot of examples. And that leads to the third theme, voiced by several different folks. Do these tools really know our industry? The answer is maybe. They know surface details about every industry, but they don't necessarily know what you know because so much of the specifics of an industry is behind the four walls of companies in that industry, not out in public, not on the internet. I often refer to generative AI systems, especially large language models, as the world's smartest interns. They're knowledgeable in general, very capable, very clever, but they know nothing about your company specifically. Right? You hire them, they got 255 PhDs, they're super smart, but they haven't read your emails, they haven't sat in your meetings, they have not made work product for you. And so they will be limited to what an intern would know, right? If you ask an intern on day one at your company to build your company's go-to-market strategy with no provided background information and no specific, highly detailed instructions, that is a recipe for failure. In exactly the same way, asking generative AI to do that same task in the same way with no data and, you know, no background information is also doomed to fail. AI tools know as much as generally available plus the information you provide them. Provide the most best data in your work with them, and you'll get the best results out of them. Now, the final theme I want to touch on is who you are as a person, as a professional. We are now in the age of AI, where we are more than just individual human beings. People have said somewhat cleverly that AI stands for augmented intelligence, and that's true, if vague. It means more than just being good at a specific tool. Augmented intelligence, if we really want to extend the metaphor to encompass the true power of AI and unlock in our brains what the possibilities look like, what our futures look like, is about you plus your AI team. Let me underscore that for you. AI is about you plus your AI team. What does this mean? It means that you will have your own tooling that's part of your secret sauce as a working professional. Today, we have systems like custom GPTs in OpenAI or Gems in Google Gemini or any of the systems that allow you to build easy-to-use, pre-programmed, pre-prompted utilities. Right? You'll have, as a working professional, a library of these applications based on the prompts you've written that travel with you, that are part of your value as a professional. Suppose, for example, of the 140 architecture professionals that I taught this week, one of them develops the killer app for go, no-go proposal bidding. That person would have an outsized advantage at that particular task because they've invested a lot of time and data and effort to make it work, to the point where other companies might seek that person individually out specifically for that enhanced skill. It's not just them, the person, but them and their portfolio of apps that give them superhuman powers. And that's today. We already see the trend, the direction this is going. Google and Microsoft both announced in the last 2 weeks, you can now, in their workspace applications, create virtual team members, virtual employees within a workspace. The technology to build a virtual team member exists today, but it is technically challenging to do that. The technology to build that tomorrow will be as straightforward as a prompt and some documents. And no one says this capability just needs to be restricted to enterprise companies, right? It can be available to everyone. We already have a model for this, for what this world looks like, called agencies, right? You don't just hire Christopher Penn. You hire Trust Insights, which contains the various team members, you know, Chris and Katie and John and Kelsey and all the AI, each of whom add value to an engagement. So you're not just hiring one brain, you're hiring a bunch of brains. In fact, last week, I showed one of our clients the virtual team member we built just for them. In the age of AI, you and your AI-based team members are an agency in your own right. You are an agency. Now, there may be one human at that agency, but there's a bunch of AI. If you build it, that makes you into an agency. The implications for this are huge for the future of work. For individual workers, you should be thinking about building such a team, a virtual office of capabilities that enhance your value as a professional. People will hire you plus your team. As you build that, you will also need to keep in mind that your employment contracts will, or at least should, look less and less like employer-employee relationships and contracts, and more like business-to-business contracts, the same way that you would contract Trust Insights as your agency partner. What does your future agency of you, the human, plus a dozen or 100 of your AI team members look like? For companies, you should be avidly protecting your data because your data is your strategic advantage. So you should know where it is, know what condition it's in, and protect it. Giving it away is going to be far more harmful tomorrow than it is today. Not knowing where it is going to be far more harmful tomorrow than it is today. You will want to negotiate carefully with partners, be clear and fair with your employees, and be cautious about what you share with technology vendors. Anyone who works in the AI space understands just how valuable good quality data is, how difficult it is to obtain, how scarce it is. In fact, one of the new jobs that generative AI has spawned is dedicated content creation roles specifically to build training data for AI. A friend of mine just got a contract job just doing this. All they do is write, but they write content that never sees the light of day outside a server room. It's not on the internet. It's not in public. It's about very specific topics, and they are being compensated to create stuff just for AI. Now, is this going to be the future of every professional? No. Is it going to be the future of the most valuable professionals? Probably. Someone who understands the value of their knowledge also understands making that knowledge scale, making that knowledge work even when they themselves are not working. We have old legacy models like writing books and self-paced courses where people can make use of our knowledge indirectly. Now, with virtual team members and AI agents built in our image, we have far more capable, rich ways for people to work with us anytime they want. I look forward to meeting the agency of you in the near future. As always, shameless plug, if you want me to come speak at your event or train your team, as I've been doing the last couple of weeks, that's literally what my company does. And when you hire Trusted Insights, you get me and my army of agents. So hit me up. There's a link in the newsletter for that. All right, what else happened this week? This week, I did some stuff on optimizing content for generative AI, what people should be doing about that, plus getting a sense of what rights you might have signed away, and some ways to identify good generative AI use cases. Here's a hint, templates. What else happened this week? We got a bunch of new jobs. Let's take a look at the jobs here. We have analytics engineer at Peak Design. We have analytics engineer at W Promote, content strategist at GrowGetter, data cloud and AI at Further, digital analyst of CRO at Patriana, marketing data analyst at Road Surfer, marketing operations manager at Marketing Ops, product analytics lead at YOLO Group, senior digital optimization analyst at Royal Caribbean Cruises, solution architect at Snowplow Analytics, both in the US and the UK. So lots of hiring going on there. Upcoming events, I've got the MakeOn conference in Cleveland, the Trace One user conference in Miami, and the Marketing Crafts B2B forum here in Boston, plus a bunch of stuff that is not on the calendar yet because we're still waiting on paperwork to get it organized. But that is the news for this week. I hope that you find it useful. I hope that you are thinking about what your AI-powered agency of the future looks like, because it's coming, and hopefully you're in the lead. Hopefully that you are one of the first people that has these capabilities you can bring it to market. Thanks for tuning in. I'll talk to you soon. If you enjoyed this video, please hit the like button. Subscribe to my channel if you haven't already. And if you want to know when new videos are available, hit the bell button to be notified as soon as new content is live.